So you're watching a mythology video, so that probably means that you're familiar with Srinivasa Ramanujan, one of the most ingenious mathematicians who ever lived. And you're probably also familiar with his strange counterintuitive identity, 1 plus 2 plus 3 and so on is equal to minus 1/12. If you don't know about any of these things, check out my video about this. Ramanujan is also famous, at least among mathematicians, for this strange infinite 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 expression. It's an infinite nested radical. And he says it's equal to 3. And I actually can give you his argument, which is very, very pretty. So he says 3 is equal to square root of 9. Well, yes. And 9 is equal to 1 plus 8. 8 is equal to 2 times 4. 4 is equal to square root of 16. 16 is equal to 1 plus 15. And 15 is equal to 3 times 5. And 5, of course, is equal to square root of 25. And you can probably see how this continues. But let's just do one more. 25 is equal to 1 plus 24. And 24 is 4 times 6. And 6 is equal to square root of 36. All right. Now, all these expressions that we've seen here, they're all equal to 3, obviously. And so since this continues on forever, he says, this shows that the infinite expression itself is equal to 3. And that sounds pretty convincing, doesn't it? Until you figure out that you can do exactly the same thing for 4. And let me show you that one too. So here we go. So 3 is equal to square root of 9. Well, 4 is equal to square root of 16, right? And now Ramanujan rewrites like this. Well, square root of 16 I can rewrite like that. Okay, so 1 plus 2. Now, he rewrites like that. I rewrite like this. And I can actually go on forever, just like Ramanujan goes on forever. So we're pushing numbers ahead of us. Here's square numbers. Here's weird blue numbers, but they're always going to be there. And if you accept that this argument here shows that the infinite expression is 3, then you should also accept that the infinite expression is equal to 4. Well, then of course we're in trouble, right? 3 is equal to 4. Something is definitely fishy here. So it seems that even famous mathematicians like Ramanujan sometimes get it a little bit wrong. Okay, well, have a look. Ramanujan was really, really interested in infinite expressions, and he was a real master of figuring them out. So there's infinite sums like this, there's infinite products. These guys are called power towers. That one up here is very funny. If you haven't seen it yet, there's a video by Vihart in which she talks about lots and lots of different infinite expressions. And this one is supposed to be equal to the mysterious number wow. If you haven't watched that video, you absolutely have to watch it. And then, of course, there's this fraction here that a lot of people have been waiting for. So just recently I did a video where I start with 1, and then from 1 I grow this infinite fraction, just like Ramanujan grows this infinite nested radical starting with 3. But then I also show that you can do exactly the same thing starting with 2, just like I just showed you that you can grow the radical from 4. Okay, and then I asked, well, does this imply that 1 is equal to 2? And we've got a lot of really good discussions going on and a lot of ground covered, really good comments. But I thought what I'll do today is try to make sense of all these infinite expressions, kind of give you the tools next time you come across one of those infinite expressions to figure them out yourself. The very first thing you have to realize about all of these things is that to start with, they're completely meaningless. If I took away all the dots, you would know exactly what to do with any of them. But since the dots are there, any single one of those expressions asks you to do something infinitely often. And to start with, it's not clear what that actually means. So we have to actually make up our minds what that's supposed to mean, executing an operation infinitely often. But maybe before we want to do this, we want to figure out whether it's actually worth doing all this work. And there's actually a nice trick that can help you with this, making up your mind. And I just want to show you this trick. It doesn't apply to all of these infinite expressions, but it applies to many of them, all these periodic ones, basically. So let's have a look. So we're interested in this sort of thing. Looks pretty, right? But, you know, should I really waste some time on it? Well, let's see. So this guy here, I don't know what it is, but let's just call it something. Let's just call it R for root, this guy here F for fraction, and that guy down there P for product. All right, now have a close look here. This yellow bit is actually the whole thing itself. So with the R sitting inside itself. So I can actually rewrite this as R. That gives me an equation for R. So I can manipulate that, gives me a quadratic equation, I solve it. and get two solutions, of course, 1 plus minus square root of 5 divided by 2. Closer look shows that one of these numbers is positive, one is negative, nothing negative inside here. So if it's anything, it should be the positive guy. And actually this one here is, of course, a super famous number. It's the golden ratio. Now here I've got my motivation. I've got something super pretty on this side of the golden ratio on the other side. And what I want to figure out really is, are these somehow equal in some sense, right? So I'm now prepared to actually put the work in. And well, let's just do it again for this guy here, for the puzzle one. So here you also see that we can rewrite like this. We get an equation. So whatever this is supposed to be, that infinite expression, it should be equal to one of the solutions of this equation. Again, it's basically a quadratic equation. And you actually get 1 on 2, which was a bit sneaky of me, but I knew that some people know this trick, they would be applying it. And so at that point in time, you actually figure out, well, it doesn't give me anything new because I already started constructing these things from 1 and 2. And then finally, this guy here looks a bit weird because 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, well, obviously that explodes to infinity, shouldn't have any value. But let's just say we're not very careful. Yeah, and we just kind of follow our nose here. Well, then we see that there's a p here. And now we ask, what's a number that satisfies p is equal to 2p? Well, there's only one of them, it's 0. So if you're not really careful, you kind of get a prediction 0 here. It doesn't really matter in terms of motivation, like all of these right sides here tell me I really want to figure out what's going on. But it tells you, you've got to be careful with these sorts of things. Okay, so now how do we actually make sense of these infinite expressions? Let's look at a fairly simple one, infinite series. We're supposed to add infinitely many bits here. That sounds hard, don't know what to do, but at least I can get started, right? So I'll just start adding. So we've got 1, okay, then I add 1/2, gets me this guy, and I just keep on going like this. And these guys are called the partial sums of this infinite series. And with this particular one, it's actually easy to see. There's a nice pattern here. I know what comes next and so on. Also, these are increasing and they're converging to 2. Actually, 2 is greater than all of them. And 2 is actually the smallest number greater than all of these guys here. Now have a look at this guy here, right? So we don't really know what it is, but if it corresponds to a number, some number, that number should also be greater than all of these. So now you step back just a step and have a look at all this and you say, well, really the only number that really qualifies here is 2. So now we actually define the sum of this guy to be 2. That's us doing it. So we are actually somehow gods in this respect. We are actually giving this a meaning. And we're doing this in general for this infinite series. So get an infinite series, translate it into the sequence of partial sums. Does the sequence converge to a number? If yes, then this number is declared to be the sum of the infinite series. If not, well, the series is divergent and you have to maybe try something else, something non-standard. This is the standard approach. There's also non-standard for that. Check out the 1, 2, 3 video. Puzzle fraction, what do we do with this one? Well, again, we'll just start calculating. So let's start calculating. Okay, first result here is 2/3. Do another one that pans out to be 6/7, and we keep on going like this. And again, we see nice pattern here, numbers getting bigger and bigger, sequence converging to 1. And so obviously this should be equal to 1. That's a reasonable way of assigning a value to this. Probably the most reasonable one. Except when you really think about it, there's actually at least one more totally different reasonable way of associating a sequence of numbers to this one. And well, let's have a look. Well, if we stop calculating here, then actually the first number is 2. And then if we stop there, well, 2 divided by 3 minus 2 is 2 again. And if we do it again and again and again, actually all the numbers that fall out of here are 2s. And so obviously this guy here converges to 2. And so another way of associating a number to this infinite fraction would be 2. And actually, if you're the first person to look at this guy here, then, you know, there is no real preference for one or the other. Both are pretty reasonable, okay? But in this case, you're not the first person to look at it. Actually, people have been looking at it for hundreds of years, and there's a whole theory of these infinite fractions here. And within that theory, it actually turns out that the first way of chopping up and generating the sequence is the way to go. Because it's applicable, it's useful, it's just it, right? Whereas the second way of associating in a number is not it. So by default, if somebody shows you an infinite fraction like this today, in the context of the larger theory, the answer is this guy here is equal to 1. But just in general, if you're facing an infinite expression, there could well be a couple of different ways of associating a number to this that are perfectly reasonable. What about Ramanujan's infinite nested radical? Well, let's just calculate. Chop off here, okay, chop off there, and keep on going like this. Now just display some of the numbers you come across here. Well, these numbers are creeping up again. The pattern is not as apparent as with the other examples I had, but it actually seems that we're creeping up to 3. And you can actually prove that this sequence of numbers here converges to 3. Okay, so Ramanujan was right about this thing being equal to 3 in some sense. Is there another way in which you can associate a sequence to this? Yes, there is. So we can chop off here, we can chop off there, but you can actually see that when we do this, we actually eventually end up with the same numbers. It's also easy to see why. With this particular infinite nested radical, there's really only one way of associating a number to it, one good way, and it's 3. Okay, so Ramanujan was right about the 3, but the argument he gave was not quite complete. The context in which all this stuff comes up is actually a puzzle. You know, just like I give these puzzles in my YouTube videos, mathematicians sometimes challenge other mathematicians in math journals. So this was a challenge like this. And actually, Ramanujan challenged other mathematicians to figure out what it is. And after a while, nobody gave a response, so then he had to give his own answer, and that's his answer here, which you can check out. I've linked it in the discussion. Actually, he gave a second challenge. It's this guy here, and so if you feel particularly brave today, you can try and figure out what this one is. And depending on your mathematical background, you can actually, you know, prove whatever you come up with here. And, well, if that's a bit too hard, then maybe try and figure out whether this guy here is really equal to the golden ratio. Or what's all this business with wow? So is this equal to wow, or what is wow? So try and figure that one out. Maybe also have a look at Vihart's video and check out some of these other infinite expressions and make sense of them. And then maybe finally one of my favorite equations, solve for x. Have fun. You're probably a calculus specialist and you've heard about infinite series, you know about infinite products, and you know about infinite fractions like this, or continued fractions. But what about all this other stuff? Do they actually show up anywhere apart from these particular types of infinite expressions? Yes, heaps. So let's just have a look. So this guy, for example, can be defined totally in terms of this infinite expression here. So the C stands for a complex number. Now, first of all, we need to know how we chop these things up to get our infinite sequence of numbers. So the way we chop this up is like this. The Mandelbrot set is a subset of the complex plane. So a point is either inside the Mandelbrot set or is outside the Mandelbrot set. And to decide whether it's inside or outside, you can use, or you do use, this infinite expression here. This is a complex number, that's C, okay? Now we evaluate this guy here, which corresponds to making up this infinite sequence of numbers. If this infinite sequence of numbers is contained in a finite region of the complex plane, and doesn't explode to infinity, then the point is inside the Mandelbrot set. If, on the other hand, that sequence of numbers explodes to infinity, then it's outside. And in fact, depending on how fast it explodes to infinity, you give the point a different color, which then gives you this strange halo effect around the Mandelbrot set that you see often in pictures. If you actually check out my Mandelbrot set video, or if you check out, or if you know anything about Mandelbrot sets, you probably haven't seen this infinite expression here. But what you have seen is this here. So what everybody who knows anything about the Mandelbrot set knows is that we figure out whether a point is inside or outside using this function here. And what we do with this function is we iterate it. And doing so is the same as evaluating this infinite expression. I'll just show you how this works. So you initialize with x equal to 0. So you fit in it here, 0 squared plus c is equal to c. What we get out, we just feed into this function again. So we have to square and then plus c. And then this guy here gets fed in again. So we square and plus c again. And you can see it's basically the same thing, right? So iterating a function is the same thing as making one of those infinite expressions here. Our trick has something to do with these iterated functions. The answer it actually gives the trick is to a question that we're not really posing. So this guy, for example, here, that corresponds to one of those iterated functions. The function is this guy here. And you've seen this one before. That comes up when we set up our trick, right? So there's the f, so there's the function, there's the function. Now when we solve for f, the values we get here, well, that's 1 and 2, these are the fixed values of the function. So what that means is that if instead of 0 I initialize with one of those fixed values, the infinite sequence of numbers that gets spat out here is constant 1 or constant 2. So these are very special. And actually, they are super duper special. So basically, when we're talking about the infinite expression, we're talking about one particular sort of initialization for this iteration process, or maybe two, or maybe three specific ones, depending on our interpretation of what that infinite expression might mean. But really, what the answer here is about all possible infinite sequences and their behavior given different initializations. The answer 1 and 2, what it says is that no matter how I initialize here, if the sequence of numbers actually converges to anything, it's going to be 1 and 2. And then actually, 1 and 2 can happen. Because if you feed in 1 and 2, you really get 1 as constant sequence, 2 constant sequence. So the answer that we're getting to our question here, we might sometimes get lots of answers or a slightly misleading answer, it actually does make sense in this context. Right? It's a complete answer there, but it's too much of an answer really for what we're interested in when we're looking at infinite expressions. To analyze these sorts of things, there's a huge literature there and lots of really beautiful stuff. So basically what you have to investigate are these fixed values of functions, and there's nice theorems there, fixed point theorems, and we're going to talk about these in future methodology videos. So something to look forward to. And that's really it for today.